Welcome back, Generals. Today we get to have some fun repelling the CSA at Thoroughfare Gap on Major General Difficulty in version 1.28.4 of the J&P Mod. Overall, the battle went well and it was fun to play. Before we get started, I want to say thank you for taking the time to check out any of my materials related to the game. I hope that you find something to help you achieve success in your own campaigns. Do not hesitate to ask questions in the comments. Be aware that Colonel, Brigadier General, and Major General difficulties all share an AI profile. Legendary has its own profile. Therefore, things that you see me do should easily translate to lower difficulties, but may not work in Legendary or be suboptimal. My career point from Kettle Run went into medicine to get that started. I took the Burnsides and 20-pound Parrots with reputation points, along with Reynolds and Hancock as officers. I can take 13 units to the battle. I'm taking all four of my 2-star infantry, along with the 3 1-stars that are the closest to getting their 2nd star. I'm taking 1 melee cav and 1 carbine cav. I'm also taking 3 smoothbore batteries and 1 20-pound Parrot battery. John Gibbon has 1st Division with Wagner, Brewster, McClellan, Brooks, and McDowell. Lomax has 2nd Division with Porter and Henselman. Ulysses Grant has Martin and Frank. Brown has Walton, Woods, Scales, and Loomis. Now, while checking on scaling, I noticed that neither Thoroughfare Grap nor 2nd Bull Run scaled a lot, so I decided to take advantage of training and fill up my 2nd and 3rd cores. With 6 points in training, each unit stat can increase by a maximum of 3 points, with a cap at 26. Most of 2nd Corps includes all of my units left over from Gaines' Mill and Malvern Hill that will not deploy here. Many of them already have stats that are greater than 26, except for melee. When you build an army that focuses on accuracy perks, you're likely to have low melee stats. You just don't do enough killing in melee to increase that stat in battle. So training can help give them a boost to melee, even if everything else is above the cap. All the units in 3rd Corps are placeholders with new recruits. This will allow these units to gain 3 to every stat, plus your brigade commanders also gain experience. So this is an opportunity to boost all these officers up a bit. If you want me to do a separate video on all the different ways training effects work and ways that you can maximize those effects, let me know in the comments. The AI was reinforced with 1 core of 16,600 new recruits. That increased the AI army size by 8,000 men. Training also increased by 2 points, and the armory increased by 1 point. The AI will have 23,055 men and 64 guns, plus whatever it gets from splits. I have 13,560 men and 54 guns. Let me say this while I'm deploying my troops. You're going to find that in every campaign, there are certain battles where your playing style and your army composition are going to be major factors in determining the difficulty of the battle. For example, I struggle terribly with cross keys in the CSA campaign, yet other people have no problem with that battle. Similarly, my style and army composition seem to be a good fit for Thoroughfare Gap. I could play the battle the same way each time and repeat my success over and over. That said, I always bring the same types of units to the battle and deploy them in the exact same locations. If I change the locations or the unit composition, it just doesn't work out as well. So keep that in mind if you try to duplicate what I'm doing here. I know a lot of players fight this battle with their army in the woods to the north so that the VP is on their left flank. You might find better success trying to fight it that way. Multiple 2-star 24-pound howitzer batteries go a long way to stopping charges in the middle woods. If you don't have similar artillery developed yet to this point, you may struggle to hold the center. I will have 4 infantry to the north of the VP along with their detached skirmishers and a 2-star Napoleon battery. My 20-pound Parrot battery will sit right on the VP. I will have 3 infantry in the center woods, including the 2 best infantry units in my entire army. They will also detach skirmishers and be supported by 2 24-pound howitzer batteries. The wooded area to the far south will be held just by detached skirmishers and my carbine cav. My melee cav will be mobile and go wherever it's needed. There's a 33% chance that the AI artillery spawns with horse perks, so they may arrive much earlier than the rest of the AI units. If you're quick with your cav, you can do some damage before the rest of the AI force arrives to defend them. I don't want my units right up to the water. I want to be far enough back that the charging units have to go a long way to get to me. This will slow them down coming through the woods when charging, and also slow them down while they're trying to get away as they route. My howitzers are back in the open to avoid any damage reduction penalties from cover. The infantry are covered by their canister range and the waters within shot range. I don't worry about my rifled guns sitting on the VP because anything approaching them can be flanked from both sides well before they arrive. The AI guns are coming up. We'll see if I can get some shots on them before their support units arrive. If you can take these batteries out earlier, your total casualties are going to be reduced quite a bit. Probably take some flanking shots, but it'll be worth it to eliminate these guns. I would have rather had them shatter because I doubt I can get them back across my line before they're recaptured. It does have a horse perk, so they might make it off the board if they can limber up quickly enough. I lost 13 melee cav and 10 carbines, which is not a bad trade for two full artillery batteries. That artillery is making for some nice bait for those skirmishers to come chasing after it. I should not have charged that skirmisher while getting flanked from something that I can't even see. Yep, they routed from the flanking fire, so this is gonna hurt a bit. That infantry just sees my rifled guns sitting there in the open, but walking up to center ends up being flanked on both sides. I will have to do a ton of micromanaging in the center. Whenever a unit routes, I must switch to the next unit. It's just one massive killing field. Alright, now multiple charges have started, so this is where the fun's gonna begin. Thank you. We're right on the edge of being out of control here. I need to hold a couple of the units back to handle the AI that appears on the flank later, but if the Northern force isn't being attacked, I'll start flanking with some of these guys. I've lost 600 troops so far, and the AI has lost 3,600 troops. few of the AI units have gotten close enough to start melee, but they're so spent by the time they arrive that they immediately rout. The woods on the south end can be a little tricky. You want the detached skirmishers to be able to support, but you don't want them to cause the AI to attack in their direction. So there's the attack on the flank. My two infantry brigades, plus the one detached skirmisher and the Napoleon battery, should be able to handle them. My cav can also go up and try to capture them. The AI still outnumbers me, but it's going to start running out of condition and morale for all of its units pretty soon. As soon as I can handle this flank attack, I'll go on the offensive. One unit routing and one wavering, I'll charge with my cav. I can start moving my northern force towards the south to flank now. The AI's healthiest units are all in the south. That center section is going to start melting away pretty quick. I'll try to get the artillery to fire on my detached skirmishers so my cav can safely make a charge on them. Comparatively speaking, the AI still has quite a few men on the field, but they're a disorganized mess at this point. With an hour left, I should be able to clear this easily. Thank you. let's get some charges started, and I'll see if I can get some captures to finish this up. I finished with 380 men killed, 1,181 wounded, and 177 missing for a total of 1,738 casualties. The AI had 14,339 casualties and 1,932 captured. Wagner had 2,000 kills. Porter had 1,600 as a one-star unit. That's going to help him out. Brewster made it to Major General. We got some Lorenz rifles, carbines, DN&Cs, and some Napoleons. Thank you so much for spending some of your valuable time watching today. I hope you found something useful for your campaigns, and I wish you much success, Generals.